know, it's probably hard to imagine today that we didn't always live and work and produce through large formal organizations. And in fact, if you look at the history of humanity, of us, we can see that the whole concept of wage labor, the idea that we sell our time and our efforts for money to somebody else, is a fairly recent phenomenon, probably about 300 years, depending on who you talk to. But in terms of human history, it's a fairly small period of time. And it doesn't mean that all those thousands of years that we've been around, we were sitting around doing nothing, right? We created lots of incredible stuff. We grew food. We made things. We produced things. We traded things. We bought things. But we did it all on a small scale. We did it within our communities, within our geographic areas. We knew who we were buying stuff from. We knew who we were selling things to. So our economic relationships were highly embedded in our social relationships. They were inseparable. And really, the genius of a large organization, of a large formal organization like this, is that they managed to scale up production. Beyond your community, beyond your geographic area, you could produce lots and lots of things. And in the process, actually, we separated the economic and the social context, right? So you have no idea who built the chair you're sitting on right now, right? Well, it probably was built by a machine anyway, or the clothes that you made. So it allowed us to basically scale up production to these great limits beyond what we were capable to do before. So why did we need organizations? What is it about organizations that allowed us to scale up production? Well, this is the question that Ron Coase, who was a Nobel Prize economist, asked in his famous paper in 1937. He asked the question, why do we need organizations of any kind, corporations, governments, other universities, colleges? And his answer was, it's because of transaction costs. Because when you're producing more, when you're creating more stuff, when you're scaling up, you need to manage a lot more people. You need to manage a lot more resources. You need to invest a lot more. So it makes sense from the efficiency point of view to bring it all under one umbrella, right? So it's about these transaction costs. So you can think of organizations, in a way, as a kind of a technology. It's a technology that allows us to scale up production while minimizing costs of doing so and increasing profits. And that, I think, is exactly what is becoming disrupted today.
Are you an ENTJ, an INFP? Even if you've never used any Myers-Briggs tools to discover your personality type, you've probably at least seen these acronyms before. This is the most popular personality test in the country. Over 2 million adults use online tools such as this to determine their personality type. A shocking 89 of the Fortune 100 companies actually use this test for hiring and development purposes. And in this video, I'm going to tell you the history of the Myers-Briggs Type Indicator, also known as the MBTI quiz, and how it has become one of the most famous ways to look at different personalities. So Catherine Briggs and Isabel Briggs Myers were not world-renowned psychologists. They were just a mother and a daughter who became interested in studying personalities. The duo taught themselves about the science of personality testing through their fascination with theories created by Carl Jung. Jung believed that humans experience the world using four different functions. These functions were the dichotomies that we associate with the test today: extroversion versus introversion, sensing versus intuition, thinking or feeling, and judging or perceiving. At the time that Briggs and her daughters were researching Jung's theories, America was involved in World War II. Women were looking for work at unprecedented rates, and many of them for the first time. Briggs and Briggs Myers believed that if women could understand Jung's theories and assess their personalities, they would be able to look for jobs that would best suit their interests and personalities. So they took all of the dichotomies and created a test that would show them which side a person stood on. Their assessment determined whether a person was more introverted or extroverted, more likely to think or more likely to feel. Well, the combination of these four sides created a personality type. For example, an ENTJ is more extroverted, uses their intuition, is more likely to think than feel, and usually judges before perceiving. There are actually 16 of these personality types, and each one is likely to have certain talents or a skill in the workplace or in specific relationships. Their first version of the assessment, the Briggs-Myers Type Indicator Handbook, was published in 1944. For the next 50 years, the assessment would be tweaked and three different MBTI manuals would be published. It actually contains over 80 questions in the European version and over 90 in the American version. Certified professionals, they say, are the only people allowed to administer and deliver the results of an MBTI. Now, people can access many similar versions of the MBTI online, but unless a licensed professional is involved, they will only receive a close guess of the results. So, what do the results mean? You just took a test and you're an ENTJ, but what does that mean? In order to look at the results from the MBTI, we'll have to go back and look at how Carl Jung believed that humans interacted with their world and how Briggs interpreted his work. Jung used a lot of observation and introspection to develop theories for how people take on new experiences and how they process information. Now, actually, he didn't use too many scientific studies, and this is a fact that is often brought up by critics of this personality quiz, but his work made him one of the most influential minds of the time and certainly gives insight into how we actually do interact with each other in our world. Jung's theories and Briggs' work answer crucial questions about how we seek out and how we take in experiences. They answer these questions with four dichotomies, those dichotomies being the result that make up our personality types. So let's go ahead and explore these questions and what they say about your personality. Question number one is, where do you get your energy? And the answers are either extroverts or introverts. The first question pairs with the dichotomy extroverts versus introverts. And these are a hot topic in the discussion of personality psychology. Almost every personality quiz seems to have at least this. But there are many misconceptions about these two labels. Extroverts don't always want to get wild at a party all the time. They just get their energy from stimuli with the outside world. Introverts aren't necessarily shy and secluded. They just get their energy from self-reflection and staying within their own world. You can still be a social person and be an introvert, and on the other hand, you can also be a shy extrovert. Question number two is, how do you take in information? Do you sense it or do you use intuition? Whenever you walk into a room, how do you assess what's going on? Do you prefer to get hard facts and direct answers? If so, you're probably ranking high for sensing. Now, if you prefer to rely on your intuition, your gut, you may get a feeling for what's happening. You may look at patterns, body language, and just feel the energy in the room. That means your second letter would be an N, standing for intuition. So, the third question is, how do you actually make decisions? Do you think or do you feel? Once you have to act, how do you actually decide what you want to do? Now, you might be the type of person to create a pros and cons list and rely on logical thought to make a decision. If you are, you're probably scored high for thinking. However, maybe you frequently go with your gut feeling and you rely on the emotions that you're feeling to make your decision. Then you might have ranked a bit higher for feeling. And number four, how do you organize your world? Do you use judgment or do you use perception? When you're planning a trip, do you plan or do you leave things open to change? If you tend to be a planner, you might find yourself planning most of the areas of your life. You can use your judgment to predict what you will do next and how the next few years of your life are going to look for you. If you tend to be more flexible, you might be more relying on your perception of the world. When you perceive things to be a signal for change, then you go ahead and you make that change. Now, this dichotomy is in addition to Jung's original theories. Remember, Briggs did not use Jung's theories word for word. She simply based her personality assessment off of his work. She used it as a guide. These questions can certainly give you insight into how people work and interact with other people. And this is why it's used by so many business leaders and hiring professionals. Further research actually shows how different personality types interact with each other and how many of each type you should hire for a productive workplace. You don't want all of your employees to be extroverts, and you also don't want all of them to be introverts. So if you enjoyed this video, feel free to watch some of the other videos in this personality series. And if you want to learn more about your own personality, specifically what your Myers-Briggs type indicator result is, go ahead and check out my free 3-in-1 personality quiz in the description below. What it does is it combines three of the major personality quizzes into just one test that you can take in under 10 minutes. It's completely free, you don't even have to enter your email, and I'm going to try to predict some things about you, like your political stances, your relationship style, and even your health. Thank you guys so much for watching, and I hope you enjoyed this video.
Are you an ENFP or an ISTJ? Maybe you're an ESTP-ESTJ combination. Now, if you're sitting there scratching your head and wondering what in the world these letters mean and what these acronyms stand for, don't worry, because in just a minute I'm going to break down what it all means and give you the basics of one of the most popular personality profiles out there, the Myers-Briggs 16 types. Hi, I'm Brandon, co-founder of Life Secret Sauce, where we teach motivated professionals how to fast-track their careers, increase their social confidence, and live an incredible life by leveraging the social skills we should have learned in school, like storytelling, reading body language, and public speaking, rather than learning that it costs more to buy a new car today than it did to send Christopher Columbus 3 voyages back and forth between the New World. Think about that next time you get mad at airline prices. Anyway, today I'm going to jump in and give you a quick background on one of the most well-known personality tests, the Myers-Briggs Type Indicator. Now, the MBTI was constructed by Catherine Cook Briggs and Isabel Myers based on the theory of personality proposed by Carl Jung. Their theory speculates that humans experience the world in 4 main functions: sensation, intuition, feeling, and thinking. Now, I'm not going to go too in-depth, and I know that there are lots of concerns regarding the accuracy and validity of these types of tests, so I'm not going to tell you that everything that I say here through the course of this series is set in stone, or that if you are this personality type, that's it, and there is no other in mixing it. So my goal here is to break down each of the 16 types so that you can read, comprehend, understand, and communicate more effectively with all these different types of people, because that personality profile type may change depending on your mood. Now, if you were to take a Myers-Briggs test on a day that you're just absolutely dominating everything, got a raise at work, and everything is going your way, you may get a very different result than taking the test on the day after you lost your job and you're down in the dumps, because many of these tests are self-tested. There are quite a bit of discrepancies between how it all turns out. So rather than focus on the types themselves, what we're going to do is discuss the major differences that occur in terms of communicating and connecting with others. But before we go any further, like I said at the beginning, I want to break down those terms, those acronyms, before we go any further. So number one, introverted versus extroverted. Now, let's talk about what the term introvert and extrovert actually mean, not what we see on TV and read in magazines and all over the place. Because what the term introvert and extrovert actually referred to is, where do you get your energy? Extroverts are outwardly focused. They direct their energy out into the world and outside of themselves. They look at situations and they think, how can I affect that? And extroverts recharge from spending time with others. This section of the population, extroverts, represents about 55% of the American population. Now, on the other hand, introverts focus their energy inward. They direct the energy towards themselves and they look at a situation as, how does that affect me? Now, introverts will become drained after spending too much time in loud groups and out with lots of people. Now, this doesn't mean that they're reclusive or they hate people. They simply thrive more from one-on-one situations. Now, it's interesting because although most people assume extroverts make up a larger portion of the population, there are a large percent of people who think that they're extroverts but are actually introverts. Now, step number two, sensing and intuition. Next, we're going to talk about your perceiving function, how you see the world and how you interpret it. Do you tend to focus on the facts or the possibilities? If you're on the sensing side, this means that you take in information from the five senses. These are the type of people who are highly practical and down to earth. This means that they notice, remember, and are accurate with details. 65% of Americans identify with being sensory. Now, if you're intuitive, this means that you would rather focus on what could be, the imaginative, the what ifs. You're curious and open-minded. They question why things are related, and intuitive people can easily imagine the possibilities. Now, they see subtle patterns and can make connections that many people don't see. They're always looking ahead, and those that identify as intuitive make up about 35% of Americans. Number three, thinking and feeling. The third category regards our decision-making process. Now, thinkers will step back, look, and assess a situation based on objectivity, the facts and figures, and that analysis of them. 65% of men fit into this category, and thinkers enjoy a good debate because they like to use their logic and they will adhere more firmly to principles that they consider important. Feelers, on the other hand, step forward and decide based on their personal values. How do they feel about an issue? How will this influence their lives? And about 65% of women fall into the feeling category. And number four, judging and perceiving. Now, the final category to work through is regarding your lifestyle. Are you a judger or a perceiver? Now, a judger doesn't mean that you're judgmental, and a perceiver doesn't mean that you have to be perceptive. Judgers simply like things to be settled. They are the decision makers, and they often feel unsettled if things are all left in the air and spontaneous. Perceivers, on the other hand, thrive in these situations. They don't like making decisions, and they may avoid making them altogether. They're hesitant to commit, they're spontaneous, and they do really well with surprises. Now, perceivers are not as planned and organized, and they're more likely to be the ones with unfinished project or clothes and messes left all over the floor. Now, how you feel, act, and communicate becomes a sliding scale of these four properties: introverted, extroverted, sensing, feeling, thinking, perceiving, judging. All of these come into play, and each one is a sliding scale. What the Myers-Briggs type does is take each of those four combinations of four different types and create 16 combinations of 16 different personality. It's a lot. I'm not going to lie. There's a lot to it. But over the next few weeks, we're going to break down each one of these types to understand how you can see, communicate, identify, and work with all these types of people. So we're going to keep it simple, show you what questions to ask, what to look for, and how to read others. So if you're ready for more and you want to jump into this, tune in next Friday as we are going to start with our very first Myers-Briggs personality type. Lastly, if you like what we're all about, click subscribe right down there in the corner so that you never miss a video. We've got Sam always on Mondays with life lessons from TV shows. Wednesday is our expert interview series, so you can learn the top tips and tricks right from the pros themselves. And then on Friday, for the next couple of weeks, we're going to be breaking down the different Myers-Briggs types. Last but certainly not least, head over to our website, lifesecretsauce.com. Sign up for our newsletter so we can send the awesome directly to your inbox. And until next time, ciao for now.
Trait psychology is an accessible way of looking at personality science. See, we use traits in everyday life to describe ourselves, describe others, and our behaviors. But which traits bring us all together as humans, and which one separates us as individuals? So in the past couple videos, I've described how personality psychologists have narrowed down the infinite list of traits to the most important traits that are present in all people. These traits are usually presented on a spectrum. For example, extroversion is frequently a trait present in important personality studies. All people display some levels of extroversion, but some people are definitely more extreme extroverts than others. As personality psychology has evolved, the number of important traits has changed. The so-called happy medium has included five traits that are present in some degree among all people. In this video, I'm going to be talking about these five traits and the sixth one that has made its way into popular personality psychology. So, the original big five traits are also known as the ocean model or the canoe model. Ocean stands for openness, conscientiousness, extroversion, agreeableness, and neuroticism. So let's take a look at each one of these individually. The first one is openness to experience. Now, most of these traits are actually pretty self-explanatory. The openness to experience trait describes people who are curious about the world around them and they feel comfortable trying out new things. These people tend to enjoy creative activities and are more inclined to exploring different areas of life or alternative ideas. People who score low on this scale usually don't break out of their comfort zone very often. Different activities, routines, or ideas may make them feel uncomfortable. The number two is conscientiousness, and I know it's a big word, but people who are more conscientious tend to pay more attention to detail and they put more effort into organizing their everyday activities. On the extreme end, you might call some people OCD. These people are more likely to plan out every detail of a vacation itinerary or reread their work a handful of times before they turn it in. Now, on the other hand, people who score low in terms of conscientiousness are usually more likely to let things happen without planning or organizing. In fact, on the extreme end of not being conscientious, some psychologists call this impulsiveness. Now, this is a good time to reiterate that a high score on all of these traits does not make you a better or a worse person. Depending on your values and the culture that you're raised in, you may view conscientiousness as a positive or a negative trait. In fact, like I said earlier, too much conscientiousness is associated with OCD disorders. Now, it's important to remember that personality tests will not tell you if you're a good person. They just tell you which traits you have and how they influence your decisions. Number three is extroversion. So extroverts are more likely to respond positively to the stimuli in the outside world. They feel more comfortable around lots of people and whenever lots of things are happening around them. They feel refreshed and energized after they get done talking to a group of people. Introverts, on the other hand, prefer to eliminate outside stimuli and focus inward. They actually feel drained after they talk to a whole bunch of people. You can also find introversion and extroversion on the Myers-Briggs Type Indicator Personality Quiz, which is something I'll talk about in a later video. Number four is agreeableness. People who are more agreeable are more willing to take action in order to make peace with others. Agreeable people are also more likely to be patient with others. These type of people might sacrifice what they actually want just for the sake of others, or maybe to let go of angry feelings quicker. Researchers have put competitiveness on the other side of the scale here. So you're either agreeable or you're competitive. Now, this trait still has some debate in the personality psychology world because, honestly, not very many people want to be called disagreeable, which is why they have renamed it competitive. And lastly is number five, neuroticism. Now, this is the final Big Five trait, and it's also known as emotionality by other personality theorists. People who score high on neuroticism are more likely to experience heightened feelings of anxiety, paranoia, depression, or aggression. Now, these feelings may have a large impact on the way that a person behaves or the way that they perceive the world around them. Now, just like the in the pin model that I talked about earlier, people high in neuroticism usually have higher highs and they also have lower lows. Now, I also want to let you know that there is a new development. It's called the honesty humility trait. Personality psychology is always evolving, and researchers have recently added a sixth trait to the Big Five model. It's called honesty and humility. The addition of this trait has actually called for some tweaks to the acronym. Researchers have added an H to the Big Five. They started to represent extroversion with an X, and then they changed neuroticism to emotionality. And then they can change the acronym to form these six traits, and they call it the Hexico Model of Personality. Basically the same thing as a Big Five. The honesty humility trait was starting to be added when the Big Five started to expand beyond American studies. Researchers began to assess whether or not the Big Five were present in languages other than just English. And as the research continued, they realized that all of the Big Five traits were present, and honesty and humility kept appearing as an additional trait. Now, some personality psychologists believe that the honesty humility factor is the polar opposite of the traits found in the dark triad. The Dark Triad is another personality quiz that I'll be talking about next, so if you haven't already, hit that subscribe button and the bell icon. A person who is more honest and humble is less likely to be narcissistic, psychopathic, and a Machiavellian leader, which are coincidentally the three traits that I'll be talking about in the next video. Not only does the addition of the honesty and humility reveal a person's tendency to tell the truth and play by the rules, it could also reveal who has a tendency to be manipulative or a seriously negative influence. So where can you find the Big Five and the Hexico tests? Ashton and Lee, the psychologist behind Hexico, have a test on hexico.org where you can see where you rank for each of the Hexico terms. And they even have a part of the website where you can actually assess a friend's Hexico inventory by answering questions about them. Now, psychologists are still collecting data related to Hexico inventory, so your results will be recorded and probably used in further studies. So you can go ahead and try the Hexico test with that link in the description, but I've also developed a 3-in-1 personality quiz that you can take on my website. It's also in the link in the description. It combines the Big Five, the Dark Triad, Triad, and the Myers-Briggs Type Indicator personality quizzes into one quiz that you can take in under 10 minutes. So I highly recommend you to check both of those out. Give these tests a try and see what the Big Five results and the Hexaco results say about you. And if you want to, you can even share the results with your friend, and usually you can get them to take it too. If you're surprised by your results, or maybe your peers' assessments of your personality, then it might be time for some self-reflection and maybe some activities to increase your self-awareness. Thank you guys so much for watching this video. I really hope you learned something. And if you did, leave a comment below. Thanks for watching.
There are multiple talents and there are multiple temperaments, and that's where the Big Five model comes in. So people differ in extroversion, and extroverts are more likely to be good at sales jobs. People differ in negative emotionality, despite what the California Labor Board ruled yesterday. People differ in sensitivity to negative emotion. Women are more sensitive, on average, to negative emotion than men. And the effect size of that is something like if you took a random woman and a random man out of the population, and you had to lay a bet on who had higher levels of anxiety and emotional pain, and you bet that it was the woman, you'd be right 60% of the time. So it's an interesting stat, because men and women are more the same in emotional, in sensitivity to negative emotion than different, but there's a offset at the mean. And what that also means is that if you took the top 100 people, top 1 in 100 people who are the most sensitive to negative emotion, they'd almost all be women. Now, you see the inverse of that in some sense with regards to criminality. So males are more aggressive than females, and it's about the same difference. If you take a random woman and a random man out of the population, you had to bet on who was the most aggressive. If you bet it was the man, you'd be right 60% of the time, which isn't that much of the time, right? It's deviation from 50-50, but it's not 90-10. It's just 60-40. But if you take the 1 in 100 persons who's most aggressive, yeah, and that's the person you throw in prison, by the way, they're all men. 9 out of 10 of them are men. And so one of the things, and this goes to the complexity argument that you were talking about earlier, that it's hard for people to have a multivariate discussion because we like to collapse things into single causes. But it's also hard for people to understand the statistical reality of distributions, because you can have two distributions that almost entirely overlap and have walloping differences at the tails.
Yep.
And the tails are where all the action is. Like, who cares how aggressive you are? As long as you don't shoot or stab someone, you get to be aggressive. But if you're so aggressive that you shoot or stab someone, then you end up in prison, and you're the person that we're concerned with, and maybe that's 1% of the population. It's like, yeah, well, they're all men. And you see, this happens in less dramatic form, too, when you look at phenomena like career selection. So it's just a data set released the other day, and this is the first time I'd seen this, showing quite clearly that as This is a remarkable finding, and it builds on some earlier research, which the California Labor Board also decided was pseudoscience, which is absolutely 100% not pseudoscience. That is so wrong. No serious scientists debate the data that I'm describing. That nobody has debated it since like 1990. So it's very well settled science. If you look at career choices between men and women, what you find is that they're driven in large part by temperamental differences. So that would be in the Big Five: extroversion, neuroticism, agreeableness, conscientiousness, and openness. And also by interest, because the biggest difference between men and women that's been measured psychometrically, forget about the physical differences, but the psychological differences, is difference in interest. And it's actually pretty big. And so men, on average, are more interested in things, and women, on average, are more interested in people, and it's a one standard deviation difference, which is a big difference by the standards of these sorts of differences, and it's enough to drive a couple of phenomena. Phenomena one, most nurses are women. Phenomena two, most engineers are men. Why? Has nothing to do, or very little to do, if any, with differences in mathematical reasoning ability. And I mean, that's been tracked too. So if you take junior high kids, men and women, girls and boys, and you take only those who are off the charts in terms of their mathematical interest, the gender difference isn't that great. There's a tiny edge for boys, but not much. And it's even disputable whether that edge exists. So let's assume it doesn't, for the sake of argument. If you track those kids across time, what you find is a disproportionate number of the men go into the STEM fields and hardly any of the women. And the reason is they're good at it, but they're not interested in it. So in the end, then you might think, well, that's sociocultural, right? We could change that. It's like, no, sorry, research has already been done. So imagine you could rank order countries by how gender neutral their socioeconomic policies were. And then you put the Scandinavian countries at the top for obvious reasons, because they've been pushing that for like four decades, and have made a lot of progress with it. The biggest differences in temperament and interest in the world between men and women are in the Scandinavian countries. And the data now have revealed that there's a correlation between how gender neutral the country is and how big the differences are between the men and women, and the difference is positive, not negative. And then you think, well, is that reliable science? Or are the right-wing conservatives driving this scientific agenda? And the answer to that is, there are no right-wing conservatives in psychology. There are none. I'm dead serious, man. I'm dead serious about that. So here's why this research is reliable. It's because the research is reliable because the people who generated the findings hated them. They hated the findings. They were completely biased in the other direction, because everyone was hoping, everyone who's a social scientist, was hoping that as you flattened out the gender differences in the sociological landscape, you would decrease the personality differences, the individual differences, and that's not what happened. You maximize them instead. It's like, uh-oh. That wasn't what we expected. And believe me, people just didn't run to the publisher and publish these data sets. They were shocked by them. And so they replicated them. And these have been replicated across samples of tens of thousands of people and dozens of countries. It's extraordinarily reliable. It is, as far as I'm concerned, apart from the hard biological end of this of psychology, where there's some unbelievably solid work done, it's the most solid social science that exists, as far as I can tell, the psychometric data. And the reason I think that is when I was starting my career, I was looking for the most solid data, because one of the things I wanted to do was learn how to predict how people's lives transformed and changed and across time and what sort of level of achievement they managed. So I was looking for the most reliable and valid measures. And it's clearly the psychometric measures are the most reliable and valid, period. No one disputes that. So except, like, you know, people in women's studies, and that just doesn't count.
బల్లా పాసేను కక్క కొ వీడియో కొ ఫోటో కగలుంది కదా కరండి ఇండియా మే
Eurolog.
Marzenie mam, wyśpiewam je. Pomoże mi pozbierać się. Zobacz, ile cudów życie bajką jest. Przyszłość będzie moja. Wygram ją, czy nie?
Myrmidons, my brothers of the sword, I'd rather fight beside you than any army of thousands. Let no man forget how menacing we are. We are lions! Do you know what's there? Waiting, beyond that beach. Immortality! Take it! It's yours!
All my life, I've lived by a code, and the code is simple. Honor the gods, love your woman, and defend your country. Troy is mother to us all. Fight for her!
So, guys, this is the group that you've been assigned to for this particular set of activities. So, why don't we just take a few minutes and introduce ourselves, okay?
For the first activity we have on our schedule, we're going to do something called the Whale Watch. All right, it's over here. So, you guys ready to try?
Yeah. It's not even fair.
Yeah, I mean, how are they supposed to do it? They have one guy and we have two.
You know what? I think our group is going to be the best. I mean, we're on this side.
This is not a competition.
I'm pretty Obviously. Sure they said that this is not a competitive activity.
We're working as a group.
Okay.
You guys just start or go?
Okay. All right. Ready? Yeah.
Jackson,
come on. I told you to go that way.
I did.
Okay, that was all your fault, okay? Like, you have horrible balance, and don't you see that you're supposed to go the other direction?
What is this? You can't blame us for that.
Yeah, I saw it. He did it.
Okay, hold on, guys. This is not a competition. If you're going to succeed at this, you actually have to work together, right? Right, Alex?
Guys, Doc's right. We need to reform a plan here. We have to work together to figure out this activity.
Yeah. Guys, I actually do think it's about weight distribution after all.
Yeah, we're going to have to all work together if we're going to want this to work. Because, you know, it's all about how we go out in pairs in our own, like, weight and stuff. So.
Yeah, I think you're right. Maybe we should try the weight distribution. It sounds like it's going to work.
It will.
Guess.
Whatever.
Okay, you guys ready to go? On three. One, two, three.
I'll go that way. All right.
Whoa. Wait. Right here, it's coming down. Go a little slower.
You're good on my side.
Oh, it looks like it's going much better when you're sliding your feet instead of picking them up and placing them.
Consistently at the same pace.
Good job, girls. It hasn't touched yet. You're almost there.
Oh, sorry.
Oh, yeah. Thanks. Thank you. That was awesome.
Better watch your leg. We don't want to mess around.
Why'd you throw the stick at me?
Sweet.
If we're going to be successful, everyone has to team and work together. So, you know, you have to calm down a little bit, all right?
Okay, fine.
Just do it for the group.
Okay, I'll do it.
Okay, guys, on the count of three, step on the platform. One, two, three. Good job.
All right, whoa. Emily, don't go so fast. Train it a little bit more. All right, now start coming, Emily. All right, come a little bit more, Emily. All right, you guys are doing great. Just keep up that nice, slow, steady pace.
Wow, guys, we are awesome.
Yeah, we are.
Pretty good.
Oh, I'm excited.
Good job.
You ready on the count of three?
Mm-hmm.
One, two, three. Nice.
You gotta go in the middle.
Yeah, like, there's more room right here.
Three, one, two, three, go. To our group area so we can debrief this.
Alright, so how do you all think that activity went?
I think the group started out like really mean, but then it got better like as we started talking to each other more. So.
Yeah, it was definitely pretty awkward. Yeah, awkward definitely. But by the end of it, we worked together pretty well.
Yeah. Well, yeah, after we stopped arguing, good job, everybody.
That's true.
Yeah.
I'm so proud of us.
Yeah. Me too.
Okay, so now that you guys have seen how well you can work together, where do we go from here?
It was exciting that this was our first activity.
At the end of this, I am going to miss you guys.
Oh, thanks.
Thanks, Steve.
Yeah, I think we all got a lot closer.
Yeah, and we completed the challenge too.
Yeah.
Great job, everybody.
Yeah.
Patrick Lencioni, author of several business book classics, joins us to discuss his book, The Five Dysfunctions of a Team. Can you summarize for us the five dysfunctions of a team?
So the first dysfunction of a team is the absence of trust. That's when team members are not comfortable being vulnerable and open and honest with one another. The next dysfunction of a team, if there is no trust, is the fear of conflict. Because people on a team should be comfortable engaging in good, healthy conflict around ideas. When there's no conflict, then we get to the next one, which is the lack of commitment. When people won't commit to a decision because they haven't weighed in on a topic, they don't buy into that topic. Conflict enables people to commit to something. When there's not commitment, we're led to the fourth dysfunction of a team, which is the unwillingness to hold one another accountable. Great team members hold each other accountable. It's a peer-to-peer kind of thing. Because they've committed to the decision, because they had conflict and they trust each other, of course they'll enter the danger and hold each other accountable for what's necessary for the team. And then if there's not accountability, then we have the fifth dysfunction of a team, which is the inattention to results. And what that is, it's when team members aren't focusing on the collective results of the team, they're focusing on their own ego or their own budget or their own department or their career.
Who is this book written for?
I specifically target it to executives in a company, but it's not limited to them. Luckily, and I'm glad to know that people from churches and sports teams and the military and nonprofit and schools are using it as well. So it's very broadly based, but it was written about an executive team because that's how I started my company, working with CEOs and their teams.
Backstabbing and office politics can really cripple a company's operations. How can a leader curtail or stop this kind of interaction?
Well, the first thing they need to do is build trust on a team, because politics is a very natural result when there's a lack of trust, because then people are trying to to organize what they say in a way that manipulates the audience, or that trying to win rather than really solve the problem. But the other thing that a leader has to do is call it out. There's nothing more powerful than when you see someone say something that sounds like it's passive aggressive or political to say, you know, that sounded pretty passive aggressive or political. You take the oxygen out of the room and you make it so it's very difficult for someone to continue to do that.
How can the new leader of a team not be intimidated by the team?
A new leader on a team is so tempted to not let people see them sweat, to be perfect. But truthfully, the best way to overcome intimidation among a new group of people that you have to lead is to be very comfortable with your own vulnerabilities. People want to follow a leader who's real and human. And so when they see that a person knows who they are, you know, faults and strengths alike, they're much more likely to trust them and to do what's asked.
Tell us about some of your other best-selling books.
The Five Temptations of a CEO was the first book I wrote, which was based purely on my observations of various CEOs and leaders I knew. The Four Obsessions of an Extraordinary Executive is about our entire practice, how to build a healthy organization, one that minimizes politics and confusion and maximizes morale and productivity and retains really good people. I started my own company to help organizations be more effective, but The Three Signs of a Miserable Job is my first real addressing of that issue head on.
You also have a book called Death by Meeting. Why is it that so many meetings fail to accomplish anything?
People don't want to sit in a room for an hour or 2 hours and be bored. And there are things that you can do to make meetings less boring. But the other reason, which is even more important, is they lack context. Meetings are too often a combination of every topic under the sun, which ends up really accomplishing nothing. Meetings have to have more focus and more clarity so that when people go to that meeting, they know why they're there.
Your models are so simple and actionable. Tell us how they're developed.
The field research I do is just working with my clients, and I enjoy that a lot. And that's where I get the ideas. All of my ideas come from the real world. The other thing is, as you said, they're all very simple. And that's because I'm a real believer that we overcomplicate things too much. When we overcomplicate things, we make it hard for people to grasp it and put it into practice. And my readers seem to really appreciate that.
Well, thanks so much for speaking with us today, Patrick.
Thank you, Brooke.